2 cups of milk in here. Hi everyone, I'm Claire Saffitz. Welcome to my home kitchen. Today I have my version of a tres leches cake. Tres leches is a beloved recipe in Mexican and Central American baking traditions, and this is a little bit of an atypical version, but it is so delicious. I incorporate toasted hazelnuts. I love this cake because it's tres leches, 3 different kinds of milk, and I'm a dairy lover, so this is really the cake for me. It's so, so good. Tres leches cake traditionally is a very light sponge cake. It's lightened with beaten egg whites that is soaked in a combination of sweetened condensed milk, evaporated milk, and whole milk. So those are the 3 milks in a traditional tres leches. I love that there's so many variations on it. There's like coconut versions that use coconut milk. There's versions that use other non-dairy milks. There's, you know, you can flavor the milks. There's so many ways to approach it. And so when I was thinking about how would I do my version of a tres leches cake, I thought about sort of incorporating other types of flavors. And there, I had an idea in my head that I just could not sort of let go of, which was the idea of a sponge cake that's lightened not with beaten egg whites, but with whipped cream. And it felt like the perfect application to put that in a tres leches cake because it is such a dairy-focused cake. When I tested the recipe, it really called out to me for a toasted nut, so I incorporate some toasted hazelnuts. It's sort of an unexpected but very, very special version of a tres leches cake. Lots and lots of dairy in this cake. For the actual sponge itself, I'm starting with 7 large eggs, 1 cup of granulated sugar. I have 1/2 cup of hazelnuts that were already toasted. Blanched is better if you can find blanched, finely chopped. 3/4 teaspoon of cinnamon, 2 teaspoons baking powder, kosher salt, all-purpose flour for the sponge, vanilla extract, 1 1/4 cups heavy cream. That's for the sponge. Then for the soak and assembly, I have 4 cups heavy cream. There's a lot of cream in this cake. Some of that gets whipped and spread on top. 2 cups of whole milk. I am using sweetened condensed milk, so the milks in this case, I have cream, whole milk, and sweetened condensed. Just a little kosher salt, and then I'm gonna also pull out some of those toasted hazelnuts and sprinkle a little more cinnamon on top. For special equipment, I have a 13 by 9 inch pan. I have already brushed the bottom with a little bit of neutral oil and lined it with parchment paper. Then I have a hand mixer. This whole thing gets done with a hand mixer. If you have a stand mixer, you can use that. There's instructions in the recipe for how to convert. Then I just have a couple large bowls, and that's really it.
You're playing that one game, aren't you?
No, I can't beat that one level, and it's really irritating me. And I was up late last night, and I was still playing it. The first step for tres leches is to make your sponge cake. I have my 13 by 9 pan lined with a little bit of parchment paper. And one thing that I want to note is the parchment paper doesn't extend up the sides anywhere, and I have not greased the sides. There's only oil on the very bottom, and the parchment has been cut to fit. So that's important. I'm going to set this aside, and I'm going to preheat my oven to 350. Now I have everything for my sponge. I'm going to mix my dry ingredients, my all-purpose flour, that little bit of kosher salt, and baking powder. So this is a style of sponge that still has what we call chemical leavening, so baking powder or baking soda added to it. Even though it's getting lightness from that cream that I'm whipping, it still needs a little bit of like lift action from baking powder. So that's the dry ingredients. Now the hazelnuts sort of function as a dry ingredient in this cake. I have very, very finely chopped my toasted hazelnuts. And that 2 tablespoons of hazelnuts for the topping is, I just pull that out. But I'm not gonna add it to my dry ingredients because I'm gonna sift it over my sponge mixture and this would just get caught in the sieve. So I'm just gonna leave that out. Then I'm gonna add my 3/4 teaspoon of cinnamon. This is a cake where even though it's not that much, cinnamon really shines. So that's my dry ingredients. Now I have that heavy cream, which I'm going to whip. So I'm gonna grab my hand mixer and 2 large bowls. Because I'm gonna do the cream in one and then start to build batter in the other. You don't really need bowls this large, but the next size down wasn't quite big enough. So I'm just gonna work in these 2 very large bowls, which does actually kind of make it easier with a hand mixer. So into 1 bowl, I'm going to add my heavy cream. I'm going to whip this. Because this cake is all about the dairy, I would also use the best quality heavy cream you can find. Then just 2 teaspoons of vanilla. And a little bit of vanilla also goes in the soak, so I'm gonna set this aside with my other soak ingredients. I'm gonna kind of beat it to medium peaks. This won't take that long because this isn't such a big bowl, but I do beat the eggs and sugar for like a very long time. Make sure you're starting with cream that's cold, otherwise it's really not gonna wanna whip. And as it starts to thicken, that's when you can increase the speed. If you were gonna go full blast right at the beginning, you're definitely gonna splatter that cream everywhere. I think I can start to increase the speed a little. I'm on like medium high. Okay, so you can see it's starting to thicken and hold the marks of the whisk. You don't wanna over whip the cream because if it's really stiff, that can make it difficult to fold and incorporate into the rest of the sponge. So this looks good to me. This is, I would say, a medium peak. So I'm gonna set this aside. The recipe has you actually transfer that to the fridge to keep it cold. But I think I'm gonna go ahead, I can leave it out. It's pretty cool in here and it won't be sitting there for that long. I have my other bowl here. No need to clean the beaters. You can just leave them there, which is super convenient. I'm gonna crack my 7 eggs into my bowl. So unlike a lot of other styles of sponge cake, I'm not separating my eggs. I'm not starting with the yolks and then beating the whites separately and folding them in. I'm just whipping the eggs and the sugar together, and that's gonna incorporate a lot of air. Make sure you have a nice large spatula. I'm gonna use that for folding the batter together. I'm gonna add my sugar. Now I'm gonna whip all of this together. I want to beat this until the volume, it'll be almost tripled, and it's gonna be super light and moussey and have kind of a ribbony texture, but it's gonna take a little bit of patience. Again, you can do this in a stand mixer, use the whisk attachment. After maybe like 6 or 7 minutes of beating, I'm not quite at ribbon stage, but it's still very light. I mean, it's gotten pale, it's doubled in volume. I have worked a considerable amount of air into this mixture, and that's what's important. So we are adding lift and leavening through just beating air into it. So that's mechanical leavening, plus all the air that I whipped into the cream, plus the baking powder that I added to the dry ingredients. The next step is actually to incorporate the dry ingredients. So I'm going to sift in the dry ingredients about a third at a time just to avoid forming lots of lumps. And I have actually kind of coarse salt, so just dumping the salt in because it gets trapped in the strainer. And then I'm mixing just on the lowest speed and mix quickly. You just want to very quickly get this incorporated into your egg mixture. And then I stop mixing once it's mostly incorporated. And then go ahead and do, you know, another 2 batches of the dry. So quickly incorporating, and you can see that it's not really losing volume, which is what you want. You don't want to work all that air out. So I'm going to add the remaining dry ingredients. Any salt that's in there. Give it a quick mix. I actually find that mixing the flour in rather than folding prevents lumps even better. Okay, so I'm actually done with the mixer for now. I'll use it again to whip the cream for serving. But now I'm going to fold in my nuts and my whipped cream. So I'm gonna dump in that whipped cream, which is still looking great. And I'm gonna add those chopped hazelnuts and just fold everything together. This size bowl is actually very helpful for this step because of how much room I have to fold. You can see the batter is like super light. It's nice and thick as well. If I were to add a ton of soak to like a lighter, more tender sponge cake, it would fall apart. So I think Tres Leches actually needs the sturdiness of a sponge cake like this. This is somewhere between a sponge cake and a butter cake. It has the sturdiness of a butter cake, but the kind of airiness of a sponge. So it works really well for Tres Leches. So I'm gonna fill my pan. I folded everything together really gently and I have no more streaks, so that's important. You just don't wanna overmix because you don't want to deflate any of that air. So I'm gonna get this into my pan. I just wanna spread this into an even layer. You know, I think when I tackle a recipe where I don't have a really wide frame of reference, since I didn't grow up eating Tres Leches, I'm unencumbered by a previous notion that I had of what it should be, but it also means that sometimes I'm not necessarily attuned to the most traditional version of it. So this is gonna go into the oven and it's gonna bake for 30 to 35 minutes until the top is risen. I might see some fine little cracks. It's gonna be springy to the touch and golden brown all over. The soak for Tres Leches. At a minimum, it needs 3 different kinds of milk. Again, the traditional combination is whole milk, evaporated milk, sweetened condensed milk. Because I'm kind of playing on the like heavy cream theme, cream is one of my milks that I'm using. Ideally, you have like a pitcher or an 8-cup capacity, like Pyrex with a pour spout, just because that's going to make it easy to pour over the cake. I don't have that right now. So, and all my bowls are dirty, so I'm just going to mix everything in here. All right, so 2 cups of milk in here. Cream, that's about 2 cups with my soak. I have about 5 cups of soak total. And it's going to seem like a lot for the cake, but one thing I've learned about Tres Leches in my testing is like it takes a lot more liquid than you think. Then I'm going to add some vanilla extract. If you have vanilla paste, that's great. Something with a lot of vanilla flavor. Then just a pinch of salt. Salt is a flavor enhancer. It's just going to bring out the flavor of everything. Then last, 1 cup of sweetened condensed milk. I tested it with the whole can because it's kind of annoying to have like a little bit of leftover sweetened condensed milk, but it was like, to me, it was a little too sweet. If you want your Tres Leches on the sweeter side, use the whole can, that's great. But to me, it was just like a little too much and it didn't justify just calling for the whole can. So I'm gonna measure out a cup. This is not the best can opener.
It's good at removing the label.
Yeah.
So sweetened condensed milk is basically evaporated milk to which sugar has been added. Oh my God, does it use? It uses so close to the whole can. It's not a big deal to just have a couple tablespoons left over. But if you're into like a sweeter dessert, by all means, add it all. So this is gonna go in. And the sweetened condensed milk is so concentrated that it doesn't actually readily dissolve. So I'm gonna whisk this together to get that sweetened condensed milk to dissolve into the cream and milk. You can see at the bottom where that sweetened condensed milk, because it's so dense, has settled to the bottom. So I just want to whisk this until it's all incorporated. So I'm just going to set this aside and wait for the cake to be baked. And in the meantime, I'm going to get the remaining 2 cups of cream into the fridge because I want it to be cold when it's time to serve. The sponge baked a little bit faster than I anticipated. It was really done at like 28 minutes. And so we were actually wrapping up our blood orange pudding cake. So I pulled it out of the oven and just set it aside, but I wanted to show you how I'm cooling it. So when I took the sponge out of the oven, the surface was golden brown. It was springy to the touch, slightly domed. So I knew it was done. And I took it out and I turned it over onto a wire rack. And so it's been cooling upside down. And cooling sponge cake upside down helps to just keep that volume so it doesn't sink. If you've ever made angel food cake, that's a good example. You cool upside down so it doesn't collapse. So, anytime you make sponge cake, very often the top is sticky. Don't worry, don't worry. Anytime you make sponge cake, it's very common to have like a sticky layer of like eggy, sugary, like consistency on top. So that's what happened here. But the whole thing gets served upside down, so don't worry. It actually, in some ways, can be an advantage because it reveals the sponge underneath and we want that to soak up all the soak. So nothing is lost. So I'm gonna grab my soak. It's settled a little bit, but it's actually still pretty combined. So I'm gonna just give that a whisk. Wait until your sponge is fully cooled. You can see how kind of light it is. And it has naturally pulled away a little bit from the sides of the pan, but I'm glad that I didn't grease it because upon coming out of the oven, it would immediately kind of lose its grip on the sides. So that's why we don't grease the sides of the pan. It smells really good though. I love that really toasty smell and flavor that it's gonna get from the hazelnuts. See, I'm poking a lot of holes. I'm pressing all the way through to the very bottom, so that's important too. Pressing down until I hit the pan. The cake is not gonna accept all the soak right away, so I'm gonna pour slowly and let it kind of absorb like on its own schedule. So I'm pouring this all around. So I'm gonna let this sit for a minute and absorb, and then I'm gonna pour the rest. Poured about probably 60 to 75% of it. I'm gonna poke a few more holes, why not? It's gonna help it just absorb. I added all of the soak. As you can see, it's pooled on top. So the cake really needs time to fully absorb all of that liquid. So I'm gonna cover it and chill it. You should ideally be able to chill it for like at least 3 hours, not only so that the soak can absorb, but so that it can even out. So any dry areas that didn't get any like direct soak can pull that moisture in from other parts of the cake. So I'm gonna cover it and get it in the fridge and pull out my cream for assembly. Whipping 2 cups of cream with a hand mixer, it just takes a little bit of time. And I know this is like kind of a gigantic bowl, but it is easier with a larger bowl. If you have a stand mixer and it's way easier just to throw it in the bowl with the whisk attachment, obviously do that. I'm not gonna sweeten this cream. I leave it totally sugar-free because I think the cake itself has just the right amount of sweetness and it's nicely offset by having an unsweetened cream on top. And I'm gonna just whip it until I have very, very soft droopy peaks because I like the way it kind of like settles and cascades over the cake. So start on low, again, you don't wanna splatter it everywhere. And I can also grab my other two little finishing touches, which are those 2 tablespoons of hazelnuts that are finely chopped and a little extra cinnamon for sprinkling on top. It really weighs a ton. Like the sponge is light, but once it's absorbed 5 cups of liquid, it really, it's pretty heavy. So here's the cake. You can see there's no pooling soak on it. It has absorbed everything. And I just kept it covered. So I'm going to unmold it now. I didn't grease the sides of the pan. So before I unmold it, I want to cut down and around the sides. You could serve it in the pan and just spread the whipped cream over it, call it a day, that's great. But I like the look of it unmolded. It's also much easier to cut and to serve because you don't have to like get down and underneath. So I'm gonna unmold it. It's up to you, especially if you don't have a cutting board or a serving platter big enough, just keep it in the pan. So I'm gonna invert it and nothing's gonna happen because it's really in that pan. So I'm gonna give it a little tap on the counter. If it's gonna be noisy, you can put a towel down. And it might be stuck, but don't worry, I have that parchment under there and that oil underneath. So it's not really stuck, you just need to give gravity a second for it to like do its thing. You will hear almost like a suction. It's going to, when it releases, which will happen. Let's just give it a minute. Yeah, there it goes. Ooh, okay, so here it is. And a good sign of a properly soaked tres leches is that you have a little bit of soak that pools at the bottom, but not like an excessive amount that it like runs out of the cake. So I just peeled off that parchment. Now I'm going to cover just the top in my whipped cream. I think this is a perfect texture. It's holding its shape, but it's super soft and voluminous. I've said this before, and I'll say it again, whipped cream might be my favorite food. I love it so much. I'm a huge dairy lover, I'm a milk drinker, so this is really the cake for me because it's just like so much dairy, so much whipped cream. This part's really fun because you can just make beautiful texture on the surface. I feel like it's always a shame when whipped cream is like super smooth because I want you to be able to see how beautiful the texture is. So then the final finishing touch is to sprinkle the surface with my reserved chopped hazelnuts. I don't like to do it evenly. I like to sort of do like little patches of it. And then just some pinches of cinnamon here and there. So I'm gonna cut it. This definitely serves a crowd. I think you can get at the least 15 like really generous portions out of this. 20 is probably actually more accurate. So I'm gonna cut a square. So I wanna take a look at the interior. And what I wanna see is like soaked cake throughout, no dry patches. When I cut down into it, you can still hear like little tiny air bubbles popping, just telling you that it's a nice light cake. It's so good, so milky. The hazelnut and the cinnamon really enhances like all of the dairy that's in there. This is a recipe where all of the flavors like really meld and combine and form something kind of greater than the sum of their parts. It's really good. When I put my fork down there, you can tell it's like a fully soaked sponge because like a little bit of liquid starts to kind of ooze out. So that tells me that I have the right amount of liquid in here for the sponge. It might seem crazy to make a cake with a total of 5 1/4 cups of heavy cream, but it doesn't eat like that. And also it serves quite a few people. So just an incredibly delicious cake. I love this cake. And I also think it's a really fun trick that I'm making a sponge cake that's lightened by whipped cream and not egg whites. So just a fun, interesting, super delicious recipe. This is from the Easy Cakes chapter of What's for Dessert, bringing you tons more recipes from the book. So thank you so much for watching and don't forget to like and subscribe.